Welcome to Big Cove Presbyterian Church. My name is Pastor Kim. We're happy to have you here. We're happy to be here the day after Christmas. We are like a living room gathering today with very few people in attendance, and those that are here are happy to be with the Lord. And many of you are right now at home watching, which is wonderful, because I know the festivities yesterday were very special. And I think that we need to acknowledge that with the pain and stress that we've had over the last few years, that really Christmas yesterday was a time to be in God. And so now we reflect on that and move forward, and a time to be able to share our God. And that's how we'll be thinking today, is sharing with God. So I would like to do a call to worship with you today that's a little bit different. It's a clapping call to worship. And so what we're going to do is we're going to clap before each line two times. Bump, bump, bless us. Bump, bump, bless us. And that just brings us into a rhythm of excitement and joy of our Lord. Let us begin together. Bless us in the gift of your Son. Bless us as we try to obey. Bless us as we walk in your way. Bless us with your strength and vision. Bless us to feel the light. Bless us, O God, bless us, everyone. Dear God, we do feel the joy of your presence, Lord. We're in awe that you sent your Son for us. And it's hard sometimes, O God, after the season is over and the Christmas lights come down, the fragrance of pine dissipates into the air, and the Christmas music by Monday no longer plays on the radio, to understand what happens next. We need to remember that the wonder and awe of Christmas is just a beginning. Christmas reminds us that the babe born in Bethlehem has given us purpose for living, and what happens next for us largely depends on how we embrace our Savior Jesus Christ and follow him. Help us to be present in this service and to follow your guidance and share what we see and hear, like those humble shepherds so long ago. Amen.
Amen.
I'll be reading to you from the scripture of Luke. It's a little bit of a repeat. And what I'd like to do is to bring you into that scripture with a poem of confession, because I think it relates. It relates beautifully. So I'd like you to listen and just meditate. You at home as well, listen and meditate on these words. It helps us to remember that the shepherds, in the greatest visitation of their lives, responded immediately in fear. Before they walked through night roads, got dust in their shoes, and pointed their lives toward the little one, they were afraid, like we are sometimes. But then the shepherds put aside their fear and made space for awe and for going away trembling anyway. In this season of possibility, may we confront our fear and make space for awe and receive the angels who have come unexpectedly, unexpectedly to sing to us too. So friends, when there is fear in our lives for a number of different reasons, fear of being alone, fear of illness, fear of approaching the manger, fear of accepting God's call in our lives, when there's fear that surrounds us, God understands. God understands that. And God is there to help us through that. And when we stumble and fall back into fear, God is there. And so by his grace, we are redeemed. Luke 2:17-21. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary, she treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard, which were just as they had been told. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now the shepherds, even though afraid, had taken the news of the angel and followed the star to the place where the baby lay in the manger, wrapped in bands of cloth. They took in the entire scene. Baby. Son of God, announced to them, lowly shepherds. Yet they did not keep quiet. They shared the good news over and over, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard. It's kind of amazing, isn't it? That they didn't quake for too long in fear. I mean, angels came down, for heaven's sakes. But they obeyed, and they followed the news to Bethlehem, and they shared what they had seen and heard. Now, I'm not sure, frankly, folks, if it had been me, that I would have shared. I might have been afraid to share. Now, in those days, unlike today's world, the supernatural was more accepted. Angels coming down was like, oh, yeah, angels come down. It's a little different in today's world. So the shepherds, they just took it in stride and got up and shared. And you know, I think that the light shone a little bit brighter for those shepherds that night. Light of God from the heavens and light of God in a small manger. And let me tell you, those shepherds in the fields, they had known darkness. They had known very little food. Hard to find pastures for their sheep and their flocks. Months at a time away from family, sometimes up to a year. And they were often outcasts, complete outcasts from society. Yet here, in our wonderful story of Christmas, they set an example for all of us to share the good news and create light. To do that. Friends, as a way to express our faith, like the shepherds proclaiming, Christmas carols have become an important part of our Christmas tradition and a way to proclaim the good news. And as the shepherds on that wonderful day, we use Christmas carols to share the light of Christ so the darkness does not prevail. So we're going to take the time today and reflect on some of these carols. Now, did you know that carols were first sung in Europe thousands of years ago? And these were not Christmas carols. They were pagan songs sung at winter solstice celebrations as people danced around those big stone circles. And the word carol actually means dance or song of praise and joy. And carols used to be written and sung during all four seasons, not just one, but only the tradition of singing them at Christmas has really survived. Christmas began to be celebrated at the same time as the solstice, so the early Christians started singing Christian songs instead of pagan ones. But most were written and sung in Latin, a language that only the priests could understand. But by the Middle Ages, about 1200, most people, they'd lost complete interest in celebrating Christmas altogether. And that changed in 1223, when St. Francis of Assisi started his nativity plays in Italy. And the cast sang songs or canticles that told the stories of the plays. And they were in a language that the people watching they could understand, and they could join in. So, today, we'll join together as we share the good news through song and learn together some of the stories behind the stories and what they have to say to us today. Let's go back to our first song, Joy to the World, that we sang already. And this favorite Christmas hymn is the result of a collaboration of at least three people, but it draws its inspiration not from Luke 2, what we read at all. And this surprised me. It draws its inspiration from Psalm 98. I'm going to read it to you and listen for some of the words in Joy to the World. The lyrics will come through. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of a ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. That's why we clapped our hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. Did you hear some of the words for Joy to the World? So one of the more famous collaborators of the Carol Joy of the world was the English poet and dissenting clergyman, Isaac Watts. He paraphrased Psalm 98 in two parts, and it first appeared in his famous collection, The Psalms of David, imitated in the language of the New Testament in 1719. This is an old, old song. Joy to the World was taken from the second part of the paraphrase, entitled The Messiah's Coming and Kingdom. Over our next hymn. Now, many thought that it had German origins, but the meter in this hymn is actually American. For many, many years, we thought this was a little German song, and most sources note that the hymn first appeared in a hymn, not in a hymnal, not as a poem, but instead in a little book called The Little Children's Book for Schools and Families. It was a Sunday school collection published in 1885, and the third stanza that we know pretty well first appeared in an 1892 compilation. It looks like what happened, they took a prayer, they tacked it onto the end of Away in a Manger. Let's sing that together, shall we? The prayer at the end, be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay. Really interesting. I'd never thought about how the end of Away in a Manger is actually a prayer. The next song is the First Noel, and it comes from England, and in many hymnals it's considered an epiphany carol because the wise men are kind of centered in it. It's believed to date from the 13th or 14th century, a time in which all medieval civilization in Europe was just springing to life. Now, the inspiration for the story comes from more dramatizations of favorite Bible stories for the holidays, and they were called miracle plays, and they're really popular at this time. Noel is the French word for Christmas, and it's from the Latin natalis, meaning birthday. And some suggest that Noel is also related to the word novelar and nouvelle. Nouvelle, who speaks French real well? Nouvelle? Nouvelle, right? Nouvelle, I think that's how it's pronounced, meaning new. New. So birthday, new birthday. Something to tell. Most medieval poetry was written to be sung. So it's presumed that the words are written with an existing tune somewhere in someone's mind, and this makes the tune even older. Let's sing the first Noel. Was crafted in Bristol, England. And the lyrics were composed by William Chatterson Dix, who is a businessman working in an insurance company. Kind of an unlikely source, right? But in 1865, he's 29 years old, and he got really, really sick, almost fatal. And he was afflicted after that with severe depression. And this near-death experience changed him just completely. And when he was undergoing his recovery, he experienced sort of a spiritual awakening that inspired him to all of a sudden, this insurance guy, to start crafting hymns. He became an avid reader of the Bible, and he wrote the lyrics, "What Child Is This?" And then he incorporated into the tune of the celebrated English folk song, Greensleeves. At that time, Greensleeves was already one of the most beloved memories of the festive season, dating back to 1642. So What Child Is This is quite an old song. Herald Angels Sing. Now, many of the carols that we sing have a rich theological tradition, and Hark the Angels Sing is no exception at all. It's written by famous Charles Wesley, who was an English Methodist leader and hymn writer. Now, Wesley wrote over 6,000 hymns, more than any other male writer. However, I need to mention Fanny Crosby, the female writer, who wrote 8,000 hymns. Now, Charles Wesley's goal in writing the hymns was to teach the poor and illiterate sound Christian doctrine. His brother John Wesley, a famous theologian and the founder of Methodism, said that Charles' hymnal was the best theological book in existence. I keep wondering if they meant the Bible also was second to that, but I don't think so. Some have noted that Methodism was born in song, and Charles was the chief songwriter. Now, Wesley, this song is interesting. I never thought of this. The song was inspired by the sound of the London church bells while walking to church on Christmas Day. So he wrote the Hark poem about a year after his conversion, and it was meant to be read on Christmas Day. The poem first appeared in a book called Hymns and Sacred Poems in 1739. The opening line was, "Hark how the welkin rings." Welcome is heaven. And in 1753, George Whitefield, a student and eventual colleague of Wesley's, adapted the poem into the song we know today. It was Whitefield who penned the phrase, "Newborn King." So for well over 100 years, Hark the Herald Angels Sing has been a gospel-saturated anthem pointing people to the Savior. Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Silent Night, and it is just one of mystique and legend. And the words were written in 1816 by a young priest in Austria, Joseph Mohr. On Christmas Eve in 1818, Mohr brought the words to Franz Gruber and asked him to compose a melody and guitar accompaniment for that night's mass after river flooding had possibly damaged the church's organ. That's under pressure, y'all, right? Write this quick. The church was eventually destroyed by repeated flooding and replaced with something they called the Silent Night Chapel. It's unknown what inspired Mohr to write the lyrics or what prompted him to create a new carol. But an organ builder and repairman working at the church took a copy of the six-verse song to his home village. And there it was picked up and spread by two families of traveling folk singers who perform a silent night all around Northern Europe. And in 1834, the Strasser family performed it for the King of Prussia. In 1839, the Rainer family of singers debuted the carol outside Trinity Church in New York City. That's how it got here. It would soon be translated into more than 300 languages. Silent Night.
Thank you.
Now comes a time in our service, friends at home, when we share prayer requests, and we've shared in the room here a little bit to get together, and we'd like you to share as well and feel comfortable doing that. Please type in any prayer requests that you have or send them to me, pastor.bigcovechurch@gmail.com, pastor.bigcovechurch@gmail.com. We really want to hear what's on your heart. We are your church family, and we'd love to be able to know what's in your heart right now. Let us pray, everyone. God, we thank you for this time together and reflections that we've had about the shepherds and all the beautiful carols that we sing right now in our Christmas time that remind us of the whole purpose of why you came, O God. You came in the form of a tiny baby sent to save us and to save the world, but you also came so that we would know your light and learn how to share it, O God. And we struggle with that sometimes, Lord. We struggle with sharing the light, particularly when right now the world feels somewhat chaotic. We hear the virus is expanding. People are getting sick. Friends are dying. It has been a journey that has been painful. And we have people here in the room and those online, oh God, right now that are experiencing a little less than joy sometimes. And so we ask that you be with them in their time of need. And that we have people to lift up to you today, God, that you know what their troubles are. You know the losses they've experienced and what they're going through. We're just going to lift up some names to you today, oh God. We lift up Dawn and Debbie and Brian and Tennant and Diane and Betty and Sandy and David and Jimmy and Diane and Peter and Donna and Kim and Virginia and Ann and Bailey and Janie and Janice and Sophia and Cheryl. Lord, you know what is going on with all these people, oh Lord. You understand and you're right there with them. But we ask that you help them to know that you're with them. And sometimes that comes, God, as we know, in the form of grace given somehow, but in addition to that, God, we ask you on our knees to send the people that are in need an earthly angel, someone who can touch them, someone who can give them food, someone who can understand their pain. We ask that, oh God, of you. And Lord, in amongst the need and the pain and the suffering of this world right now, what we've been seeing, oh God, is glimpses of joy. And the joy starts small, God, and then it bubbles and just bubbles up. And like Christmas Eve here in this church and all the characters and the activity and the dog that was a sheep and the carried sheep and the laughter, oh Lord. We thank you for those moments in our lives when we feel your grace, your presence, and your blessings in our lives. And we ask that you expand that, make it bigger and bigger and bigger, so soon the sadness and the despair and the chaos get squished down, and the hope and the joy and the peace and the love bubble up. God with us. You have reminded us of your presence in so many ways, and also through your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now is the time in our service where we give back to God. In choosing to be born with us, God chose to be known by us, and we are overjoyed. Today we join the shepherds as they share the good news of a babe born in a manger for all mankind. Let us share our gifts with the babe today and proclaim the news of his birth. If you feel led by the Spirit to contribute, please place your offering in the offering box in the back of the room. And there is also a box there to support the Presbyterian Home for Children. For you at home, if you feel led by the Spirit to contribute to the mission and vision of Big Cove Presbyterian Church, please go to our website at
www.bigcovechurch.org.
Now let us share our gifts. God, we marvel at your love and faithfulness. At the right time, your Son Jesus lived among us and invited us to call you our Heavenly Father. Because of his obedience, you have adopted us into your beloved family. We are grateful that you have brought us through challenging times in the past. As we look forward to the new year, send your Spirit to help us trust that you will continue to guide us. Let our gifts and offerings be pleasing in your sight. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Now, it's amazing that so long ago, it's just amazing to me, that those shepherds in the field set the stage for all that was to come. They set the stage for everything. And to me, that is just amazing. They taught us, those lowly shepherds taught us, that seeing and hearing about Christ is too big, friends, to hold inside of us. It's too important not to share. And throughout the centuries, we've been sharing the good news. Our last song today was certainly a labor of love. John Wesley Work Jr. felt that way as well. He may not have written Go Tell It on the Mountain, but he can take the credit for the fact that we will still sing it every Christmas. As the son of a church choir director, Work grew up in Nashville loving music. And even though he earned his master's in Latin and went on to teach ancient Latin and Greek, his first love continued to be music. So much so that he became the first collector of African-American spirituals. And that was not easy because spirituals were passed down verbally from plantation to plantation. Very few were ever written down. But John Work proved up to the challenge, publishing several books of spirituals, the second of which includes Go Tell It on the Mountain, a carol that shares the good news and dates back to 1865 or maybe even earlier. So friends, let's share this African-American spiritual full of heart and joy. Let's tell it on the mountain, from the valleys to the mountaintop. Christ is born, friends. Christ saves and Christ will come again. Certainly is a great way to end our carol lessons, isn't it? Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. And you know, sometimes we can read the Christmas story in Luke over and over and over again. And then sometimes you think you know it all, and then a little piece pops out at you. And the shepherds sharing what they had seen and heard is really for today's world. For today's world, how are we as Christians going to shine the light in the darkness that's out there? How are we going to do that? Phone calls, prayers for people, showing up on someone's doorstep, bringing a little bit of food, giving a smile to the clerk at the checkout who looks so dismal, right? This church sending bags of love to the hospitals for the workers. There are so many ways that we can model the shepherds and sharing the love of Christ. So today, friends, know that you are loved by God and that everywhere you go, you have the light of Christ in you. So when you go and leave this place, the mission field is out there. Shine your light. Amen.